wrote this medley just like I did the last 16 years, an Oscar medley about the nominees for Best Picture. It's a wonderful night for Oscar. Oscar, Oscar. And I've got the medley right here. You want to know what's winning Best Picture? Let me go ahead and drop that bomb for you. Christopher Nolan, it's finally your year. You made the best film of anyone here. Interstellar and Inception, The Dark Knight and Dunkirk. You really should have won by now with that body of work. But it took Oppenheimer for the Academy to recognize. And just like Oppenheimer, you built a city. You built the city where they made the bomb. A whole damn city. And now you're winning your first Oscar. It's such a pity that it has taken them this long. Well, that's it. That's what's gonna win. Guess we're done here. Oh, wait. Still gotta sing about the 9 movies that are gonna lose. American Fiction. His name's Thelonious, but they call him Monk. He's disillusioned with life and he's in a funk. All the publishers keep rejecting his book because they want something black. So he reminds them that he's a black writer. He's a black writer. His brother Cliff is a new divorcee, embracing his new life, being openly gay. Their mom is battling Alzheimer's, but even she remembers that her son has always been a black writer. He's a black writer! A body found next to the house with blood soaked in the snow. Like something out of that Coen Brothers movie Fargo. But was he pushed or did he fall? Did he jump because his wife made him feel small? In Anatomy of a Fall, why did he fall down? Well, it's not just another courtroom drama. It's more, so much more intense. Can we please give that dog an Oscar for best ever canine performance? Watch the Third Reich getting along, living in luxury, what could go wrong? A large wall, a guard tower, a trail of smoke. Their casual indifference will make you wanna choke. It's the zone of interest. Whoa, whoa. So many lives lost like shoes in a pile, tossed a line that shouldn't be crossed. The horrible Holocaust. This British flick will make you sick. But that's the right response whenever you're witnessing such horror. The banality of evil. Check out all the different fellas that fornicate with Ella. Even an apple's entertained. It might be nice, but could be quite gross. That's how it goes with Yorgos Lanthimos, and she has a baby's brain. She's betrothed to Max McCandles, but she's more than he can handle, so she lets Duncan whisk her away. Fancy hotels, luxury cruises, Ella's libido ever enthuses until it's how she makes her pay. Some think it's quite obscene. what Yorgos puts up on the screen. Sex and nudity in every other scene. But it's not porn, it's just poor things. Misfits mingle in the Holdovers, set in 1970. A Yuletide film that just feels custom made for the talents of Paul Giamatti. Everybody's sure that Devine will win her Oscar, and she'll read her 100th speech. But poor Paul, with his eye all agog, might lose again to Cillian Murphy. Paul should have one for Sideways. He's garnered tons of accolades and critics' praise. But now on Oscar night, there is some doubt if he'll be smiling while dining at In-N-Out. And so I'm happy that the Holdovers brightened 2023, and that I could include this holiday tune in my Oscar medley. His uncle was King Hale, vicious, corrupt, and vile. Suggested he should marry the Osage Molly Kyle. He claimed to love this woman, but he just went right on poisoning all her insulin, watching her illness get worse, killing all three of her sisters, and her former mister resists her inquiries of how he dissed her. He's one of the killers of the flower moon. He wrote the script, he played the part, he directed himself. He's hoping that he'll win something that he can't put on his shelf. Spent years learning how to conduct, truly Bradley Cooper did. He wore the nose and all the makeup, and he's gotten close to finally winning. After 12 nominations and standing ovations, yeah. He wants to stand up there at the podium. He wants to give his acceptance speech. He wants to win that elusive Oscar that always feels just out of his reach. Two kids in Korea forming a special bond, trying to stay connected, but life always marches on. They Skyped for a minute until she got frustrated. It's a universal story of love unrequited. Past lives, there's something in my eye. Please can you tell me why? Hard to read subtitles when you cry. Past lives, we all can sympathize. All the choices that we made could have gone another way. It's just a toy the little girls play with, but now it's a film that's been nominated for 8 different Oscars, but not Best Director. It's almost impossible to get nominated for Best Director when you're a woman. Greta Gerwig is so talented and so smart, and it kills me that the voters didn't think she did good enough. Like, her direction was so extraordinary. But somehow, they only ever nominate men, and never more than one woman in the same year, unless it's right after a pandemic. And unless you're Catherine Bigelow, Chloe Zhao, or Jane Campion, you've never won. Your movie has to make money, but not too much money. And you can never say you want your movie to make money. You have to say you want it to be seen, but also it has to make money. You have to be a boss, but you can't be mean. You have to lead, but you can't squash other people's ideas. You're supposed to love being a director, but don't talk about your method all the damn time. You have to be a career filmmaker, but also always be looking out for other writer-directors. You have to answer for men's bad behavior, which is insane. But if you point that out, you're accused of complaining. You're supposed to stay pretty for the camera, but not so pretty that you're not taken seriously, or that you threaten other female directors, because you're supposed to be a part of the sisterhood of filmmaking. But always stand out, and always be grateful. But never forget that the studio system is rigged. So find a way to acknowledge that, but also always be grateful. Your film should never feel long, never be cute, never show too much, never be self-important, never slow down, never fail, never only entertain, never feel out of touch. It's too hard. It's too contradictory, and nobody gives you an Oscar or even nominates you. And it turns out, in fact, that as the director, everything is your fault if anything goes wrong. But if everything goes right, you're only part of the process. And if a filmmaker like Greta Gerwig can make a wildly entertaining box office phenomenon that incorporates multiple references to cinematic history with fun and artistic choices, and creates serious discourse about social politics and gender issues, all from a movie based on a plastic toy, and not get nominated for Best Director, then I just don't even know. Doesn't seem to matter what I do. Once my medley's through, I feel it's all downhill from here. I fear it's time to listen to those other guys, forecast and theorize why they think that they're so right about what will win on Oscar night. But they're just men making their humble predictions about what winners will be revealed when all the envelopes have been opened. We're just men, mansplaining the Oscars yet again, pondering all our picks to see how close we'll get to a perfect 23. Say hey to our host, he'll fix it in post. He's Jason O'Brien. For that extra spark, we all count on Mark Johnson for the stat line. Perhaps best of all, there's Jamie Duvall, keeps all the jokes flying. And I'm just Garney. And we're just men, waiting for this medley to finally end. so we can begin to do the show before you start to lose all your patience. Just four men. I meant the number four just then. Nothing about hair loss or that this show's intended only for a male audience. We're just men and we're all white. If you guessed middle class, you're probably right. But hey, I'm not sure we've actually never met. But we love film, yes, that I know. And now it's time to start the show. So hey, YouTube, better watch out. Get ready and get set. 'Cause here